And if you will, go to verse 1. I just also want to say that I did start a message on last Sunday entitled Understanding the Anointing of God. And I will be back on that on Tuesday and give whoever was supposed to minister Tuesday another week. Praise the Lord. Amen. Is that all right? The book of Matthew, the 21st chapter. If you will allow me to read all the way down to verse 11, okay? Amen. It says, and when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. Man, if Jesus can use a donkey, he can use all of us, can't he?
Amen.
Right? And if any man say aught unto you, ye shall say, the Lord have need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye the daughters of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon a donkey, the colt, the foal of a donkey. Right?
Amen.
And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. I know what the scripture said. Just work with me. Amen.
Amen.
And brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their clothes. And they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strowed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God for the reading of the word and for the hearers and the doers of the word. Amen. I'm going to be talking about today, what is Palm Sunday and what does it mean? Amen. And we'll just see how far we can go with this. And it's much more into this particular message than what we can do in one setting. But I want to give you some foundational truths about it and some reasons why we have to really maintain a balance in what we do, what we allow ourselves to get involved in. Amen. Is that all right? This particular passage reveals a very significant time and a set of events that transpired in the life of Jesus. They reveal what took place when Jesus entered into the city of Jerusalem 1 week before his crucifixion. But we have to be careful because the church has adopted a lot of traditions in order to commemorate special events in the Bible. Y'all got it? Especially as it relates to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, the scripture teaches that there are good traditions and then there are bad traditions, right? And you can actually even get involved in what might be called a good tradition and your heart not be in it, and there's really no benefit in it for you. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Amen. And so, and we know, of course, bad traditions are any traditions that are contrary to Scripture, right? Y'all got me? Amen. Especially, you know, when the Scripture expressly forbid our participation in a tradition that's not scripturally based.
Amen.
Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Amen. And so, reason they are dangerous is because Jesus himself said, the traditions of men can actually make the word of God of none effect in the life of the believer. And we all need the word to be effective in our lives. And we don't want to practice anything that will cause that word not to be effective. Amen. Y'all got it? Now, Palm Sunday is really not a biblical tradition. Y'all got it? I'm not saying that it's bad, but it wasn't something that Jesus established. Y'all got it? From the standpoint of it's something that we should celebrate once a year. Y'all got it? Now, there's nothing wrong with it, because if you're going to be involved in it and it causes you to reflect on what Jesus went through prior to him going to the cross, and it causes you to have a greater appreciation for his sacrifice, a greater devotion for him. Amen. If it does that, well, that's fine. That's great, because we all need to have as much devotion for the Lord as we can possibly muster up.
Amen.
Y'all got it. We should be totally and completely devoted to the Lord.
Amen.
Because he was and he still is totally and completely devoted unto us. So much so that he was willing to die on our behalf. Y'all got it? So from that particular standpoint, this tradition can be a good thing. Y'all got it? But not necessarily a scriptural thing. Can y'all all right with that? Y'all got it? Got nothing to do with your salvation, whether you celebrate Palm Sunday or not. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Amen. So what we have done, we have established various dates and celebrations and sometimes even laws that are supposed to remind us of how important the event was. Y'all got it? And if you read in the book of Colossians, it actually warns us about dates and times and seasons that we celebrate things sometime. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying?
Amen.
Y'all can stand the truth, right?
Amen.
And so one of the things that we have to be aware of is that always remember that the purpose of the event is always more important than the date of the event. Y'all got it? The purpose of the event is always more important than the day of the event, right? It's just like I say all the time around here, the purpose of your birth is actually more important than the day of your birth.
Amen.
Y'all got it? Because we were all born for a purpose, right? God did not allow us to come from eternity into time to celebrate a day.
All right.
Right? He allowed us to come into from eternity into time, amen, to fulfill a purpose.
Amen.
You got it? So in that context, when you celebrate your day, you're acutely aware that I'm also here for a purpose. That your life and my life has significant meaning in the plan of God.
Right.
And that there are certain things, glory to God, that will not get done if you don't do it.
Right.
Y'all hearing what I'm saying? You are just, Pastor, that's kind of him. Well, you are just that important.
All right.
God deemed you to be just that important. That there are certain things that he has ordained for you to do. Y'all got it? And, you know, I'll go so far as to say this. This might be a little deep for some people. I believe you can actually be saved without the total fulfillment of your purpose. But I really don't want to stand before God and say I did not fulfill my purpose. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Right. Because, I mean, a person can get saved today and die tomorrow, and they go on to heaven. Y'all got it? But purpose being fulfilled does affect your status, your rank, and your reward on the other side of this life. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Amen. And in other words, a person that does fulfill purpose, their reward might be just a tad bit heavier than yours. Can y'all handle that? Amen. And because the scripture bears that out. I mean, God is just that way. You got to whom much is given, much is required, right? You fulfill what's required, and you keep getting much. Y'all getting the gist of what I'm saying? He that winneth souls is wise. Y'all got it. And so, not to put any fear in you about it, but you want to stand before God and hear him say, well done. Not come on in here. Right? You want to hear him say, well done, right? You fought a good fight. You kept the faith, right? Paul said, because I've done that, I know there's a crown laid up for me. Y'all got it? Now, I don't want no tiara. Well, I'm supposed to be having a crown. Y'all getting the gist of what I'm saying? Amen. And so, you know, God said he'd give every man according to his works, right? He's going to pay you according to your works. And that has nothing to do with your salvation, right? So when we get to heaven, and me and Sister Kyle's house on the hill, and you on a hump, don't worry about it. Don't be hating. Ain't gonna be no hating in heaven. That kind of blow a hole in that theory about we don't work for the Lord for paper, what we can get out of it, done. Well, that ain't true. You do. Everybody that does anything for the Lord look for a reward for their doing, and that's just. And we should have an expectation of good when we're in the will of God, that God is going to bless our lives, right? More so than those who are not even trying to find out what the will of God is for their lives, right? They're just eating and sleeping. But you want to always remember that the purpose of an event is always more important than the day of the event, right? That sounds like wisdom, doesn't it? Amen. And so this Sunday has been designated by the church as Palm Sunday, right? But how many of you know that the events of Matthew 21, 1 through 11 have a greater significance than just the laying down of palms or branches in the streets for Jesus to ride on? Right? Had a greater significance than that. Amen. This particular day and the event of the day was actually the fulfillment of a prophecy given by actually several prophets of God in the Old Testament. And the purpose of the prophecy was to validate who Jesus was. Right? It was a sign that would be given to identify Christ. Y'all got it? Go to Zechariah 9:9. The book of Zechariah, the 9th chapter, verse 9. We need to know why we're doing, because there, and this is not a put down or anything, but there are churches who actually have a palm ceremony, right, where they pass out palm branches or type of a palm branches, and they lay them, and they have a reenactment of Jesus coming in into the city. You know, some churches are so large where they're literal, you know, actual donkeys. Animals that they bring in a depiction of Jesus riding on these animals, and so, and all that's fine if you understand why it was done, right? Zechariah the 9th chapter, verse 9. Are you there?
Amen.
It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion," right? and shout. So Zion, which is also a type of the church, should be a place of rejoicing. Right? The church is supposed to be a happy place. Y'all got it? Amen. And it's not supposed to be so serene till you can't sense the life of God that's present there. Right? So he said, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king, Sister Coleman, cometh unto thee. Right? He is just and having salvation, lowly, which means he was humble. Right? And riding upon a donkey and upon a colt, the foal of a donkey, right? And so this manifestation of Jesus coming into Jerusalem on this donkey was actually the fulfillment of a prophecy.
All right.
Right? That was one of the indications how you know that a prophecy actually came from God, is that when it comes to pass. Right? And God was so mindful of his people, right, was the fact that he did not want them to be deceived. He left signs and indicators and revelations thousands of years in advance of the Lord's coming.
All right.
So that they would be able to recognize him when he got there, right? Go to Psalms 24, and the Bible said it was going to be great rejoicing, right? And in our initial scripture, we found out that when he came in, there was great rejoicing, right? They cut down limbs. They throwed them in the streets. They took off coats and laid them down. And the people were crying, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord, right? Great rejoicing. Psalms 24. Y'all don't mind if I kind of take my time, do you? And go to verse 6. Twenty-fourth chapter of Psalms. Are we there? In verse 6, it says, this is the generation of them that seek him, right? That seek thy face, O Jacob, Selah. She says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors. That means open your mouth. Right? Yeah. You know, you can't praise God like this. That is not praise. Right? Right? Just looking around while praise and worship is going on, that is not praise. That is not worship. You know, I told you guys on last Sunday that I personally believe this, that every church is on a list in heaven. And we all have a specific time that we have ordained and said we were going to come before God with praise and worship. And we are on a scheduled rotation. Because we have set the time, the hour that we're supposed to be here, right? To go before God in praise and in worship, I believe that the Father is expecting us to be where we said we were going to be and on time to give him what's due him. Is that too far-fetched for you guys to, right? I believe if we had to set it for 12:30, and we agreed that's where we're going to be at 12:30, but it ain't happening.
Amen.
But if we had to set it,
right,
God would be expecting praise and worship from right of divine word at 12:30.
Amen.
Well, y'all hear what I'm saying? Amen. On Tuesdays, since we in this vein, we've set it for 7 o'clock,
amen.
Right? They wrote it down in heaven. Okay, 7 o'clock, rightly, going to be in rotation. Along with all of the other churches who have set it for 7 o'clock on Tuesday,
amen.
And God is expecting on Tuesday praise and worship.
Amen.
right? God is expecting to minister to you. Oh, God. On Sunday at 11 o'clock. And on Tuesday at 7 p.m. He's expecting to do that, right? And, you know, vaunting some justifiable reason for you not being here, he's expecting you to be here because he done wrote it down on the books. Amen. You're going to be at the house. Boy, this is a good message, and I can tell by how excited y'all are. He's expecting you to be at the house on Tuesday and on Sunday. Well, there he go. Well, you be everywhere else when you say you're going to be.
All right. Amen.
All right. Huh? If King Kong playing at the theater starts at, give me a time, 7:15, 5:30, right? If King Kong starts at 5:30, right? You might play a little bit around for the commercials, you know. But 5:25, you're going to be in your seat with popcorns in hand and a $7 Coke. You're going to be there. You're going to be on time. Wait. And going to be fussing at the folks that if they're trying to make you late. You're going to be like, yes, I am. Baby, the movie done started already. Yeah, it's an already started. But y'all can y'all see that? It's the truth. Amen. But back to the text. What verse should I stop at?
Six
says, this is a generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob, Selah, right? Says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, right? And be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the what?
King of glory.
And the King of glory shall come in. I don't know what it was me, but I thought I heard somebody say, well, my worship time is in my car. Well, that's all right. You got two worship times. You need to be at this church and in your car. That's an addendum. That's an add-on.
Amen.
Says, who is the King of glory, right? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle, right? Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, and ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Now, this is also a picture of when Jesus came into Jerusalem, right? The King of glory came into Jerusalem riding on a donkey, all right? And when he came, the people had lifted up their heads, O ye gates. They began to praise him as he came into Jerusalem. Says, who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory, right?
Amen.
Now listen, the Bible says that this King of glory, the Lord, is strong and he's mighty, right? And he is mighty in battle. Well, that was the source of their excitement when Jesus came riding into Jerusalem. Because they recognized that this was a sign of the prophets, right? And their expectation was for Jesus at this particular point in time to come in mighty in battle. And they was expecting him in that moment to subdue all of their enemies, right? They was expecting him to drop 59 on them. I see him at the time of 50. What? Y'all need to write. Y'all don't watch the news, right? Okay. Hang in there. Amen. But they were excited. Your president dropped 59 on Syria over there. Y'all all right? Amen. And the Syrian people were rejoicing. But this was their expectation, that Jesus was coming into Jerusalem at that particular time to subdue all of their enemies. Because that too had been prophesied. That when the King of glory comes, he's going to bring everything under subjection. And he's going to do it by force. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Amen. And so they were excited when Jesus came. But they didn't have, you know, proper interpretation of the scripture, not understanding that there is also a second coming. That he's going to come when he's going to actually do all of that. They couldn't see that at this particular time. He was coming, amen, as the Lamb of God who were going to take away all of the sins of the world. They couldn't see that he was coming as God's perfect sacrifice on our behalf at this particular time. But there is coming a time when he's coming back again.
Amen.
Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Now listen, even though this was a great time for those who thought they understood this prophecy, it was not necessarily a great time for Jesus. Because this was the beginning of a time of betrayal, amen, and great suffering for him before he died. You got it? It was the beginning of a time of great betrayal and sufferings, amen, before he died. Amen. And betrayal is a horrible thing, especially when it happens at the hands of someone who you thought was your friend. Right? Who said they loved you, you know, all while they were stabbing you in the back. Y'all got it? Amen. And so you don't want to be a betrayer.
Amen.
Y'all got it? If you're going to be a friend, be a real friend. Y'all got be a real friend. Don't be no betrayal, you know. Don't, it just depends on who you're talking to, who you gonna talk about. Woo! Are y'all all right? Amen. That's a dangerous place to be. You got it. One of the things that must be understood about this week after Palm Sunday, which is commonly called Passion Week, you got it, after Jesus' triumphal entry into the city. And the public acknowledgement of him as King and Savior, one of the things that it actually done was it pushed the religious community over the edge.
Amen.
Y'all got it pushed them slap over the edge. Amen. And it's an amazing thing about that when Jesus is lifted up, religion gets upset. You know, when Jesus is lifted up, isn't that a dichotomy? When religion was supposed to be looking for the king. And the king shows up, and they get upset. Go to Matthew's, the 26th chapter. And we're going to read a couple of verses there just to validate that. Matthew 26 and 1. I'm just trying to prove to you that it just wasn't just a day, right? Man, it was something significant about what he did and why he did it. Matthew 26 and 1. Are you there? It says, and it came to pass when Jesus had finished all of these sayings, he said unto his disciples, you know that after 2 days is the feast of Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified, right? Man, then assemble together the chief priests, right? And the scribes and the elders of the people unto the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and consulted that they might take Jesus by what? Subtlety, amen, and to kill him. Now, these were the very people that were supposed to have been letting everybody else know who Jesus was when he showed up. The chief priests were the presiders in the ecclesiastical affairs. The elders were those who judged civil matters. And the scribes were the doctors of the law and gave counsel to both the chief priests and the elders. And they all together created what was called the Sanhedrin Court, or the Great Council, that was supposed to govern the affairs of the people according to the law. And it's sad to say they all joined together in a confederacy or a union against the one who they claimed they were looking for to deliver them. Now that's stupid going somewhere to happen, right? You looking for your deliverer, then you get together with your other buddies and you come against him. Sad commentary, right? Go to Matthew 21 and 15. Are y'all all right? Matthew 21 and 15. See, he done rolled in the town now. You got it? And now these jokers all upset. I kind of think it's because they thought they were king. Y'all got, and one of the things that the Lord always does when he shows up, man, is that he tears down whatever man has built up. He's a threat to that. Y'all got it? Matthew 21, did I say 21? And 15. It says, and when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased, and said unto him, Hearest thou what these say? And Jesus said unto them, Yea, have ye never read, out of the mouths of babes and sucklings, thou hast perfected praise. So in other words, a child is never too young to give God praise and to worship him, right? Now, RJ comes by the house, and man, his thing is, we say, praise him, RJ. He said, so praise him. Again, he ready to clap now. Said, praise him. Then he'll one-step me. And I'll one-step him back. And then I try to get him to, and he'll, right? Because we're trying to teach him to praise God, right? Out of the out of mouths of babes and sucklings, right? When y'all in here worshiping, them children, right? And they mimic. When we pray, I watch them sometimes. If we praying, you know, they don't know what to pray, but they're looking up and seeing who praying. They know who not praying. Y'all got it? Amen. So the Bible said out of the mouths of babes, and they got upset about that, right? They got upset because they were not the main focus anymore. That's why they got upset. Y'all got it? And they rejected the one that they claimed they were looking for, right? St. John 1 and 10. Y'all get anything out of this? St. John 1 and 10. Are you there? It says, he was in the world, right? And the world was made by him. And the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. Isn't that amazing? But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. That's why you really can't get all bent out of shape just because your folks don't receive you sometimes. Ain't no big deal. Jesus already been down that path. Amen. Right? Amen. You want them to, you know, and we're praying for them. But if they choose not to, we got to be okay with that. All right. Y'all got it? You know, sometimes because you've grown up with people, you know, and they know your life's history, you know, they know your ups and your downs, you know, they knew you before you got saved. Right? And then after you get saved, you know, they always want to hold you to that old account. Y'all got it. Like one preacher said that they want to go and crawl up under the blood of Jesus and get your dirty laundry out there and shake it before your head. Y'all, are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Amen. And they don't want to receive you. Well, I know them. They know me, you know, from Pritchett, Alabama. Beautiful Pritchett, Alabama. All right. See, listen. God knew all of y'all was just like that. And what he decided in his infinite wisdom. I know what they need. They need somebody from Prochard, Alabama. Yeah, can any good thing come out of Pritchett? I'm telling you right now. It can. Y'all got it? Amen. But sometimes aren't we like that? Just because we know people, man, we kind of put them in a place where God can't really speak to me through them. Because you know them. You know, when that's not the case at all. So you got to develop an ear to hear what the Spirit has to say. And it does not matter what package he used to speak to you through. Y'all got it? Amen. And, you know, we try to teach around here for people not to have pastor salvation. Okay. You know, we got ministers around here. Oh, God. You know, that's why we don't put sometime out who ministering, because people got picks and chooses. All right. Y'all, if I'm so-and-so ministering, I ain't coming to church that night. And that's the night you should have been there. You know, because God can speak to you through anybody. Some of these children, he can speak to you if you're listening for him. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? But the Bible said he came into his own received him not, right? Now, I wonder why they didn't receive him. Now, I really believe it was because, along with those other issues, they actually did not recognize who he was. Right? How can you be looking for Jesus and don't recognize him when he comes? Y'all got it? Go to Matthew 22 and 29. Because the scripture says some interesting things about this concept. It says, know no man after the flesh. Right? But after the Spirit. The Bible talks about man looks on the outward appearance, right? And God looks on the heart, right? There have been women who have missed their husbands. I almost got drunk on that one. Have missed their husbands looking on the outward appearance. See, I got a sneeze on that one. Listen, when you already know, if he ain't that bad, you're going to fix him up anyhow. You already know you're going to fix him up. Y'all know versus Kyle's diamond in the rough story? I just want to say in my defense, I was not that rough. I had enough sparkle to get her attention. Y'all hear what I'm saying? That's how you tell it. I had enough sparkle to get her attention. Y'all got it. Amen. But my point is, listen, we put the shoe on the other foot. There have been some men who have missed their wives looking on the outward appearance. And I'm telling y'all the truth. They wind up with folk beating them. I know y'all think I'm just being funny. But we have counseled them. Where it ain't the woman that's saying he beat me. It's the man that said, I'm tired of her jumping on me. Am I telling the truth? I'm tired of beating me. I'm serious. And I'm like, you can't be beating that man. What's wrong with you? You can't be beating that man. What's wrong with you? That's why I have this kindness so I don't be embarrassed. Because I'm ready to get her now. I know you ain't beating this man. Brother about to cry. You ain't never been beat till you've been beat by a woman. I'm trying to tell you right now. When a woman beats you, you just see everything. It ain't just a whooping. You ain't got no more pride. You know, they done ripped everything out of you that was in there that was a man. How you gonna tell that? How you gonna tell your partner, man, what happened up there? Man, that woman beat me. How you gonna tell that? Yeah. Man, you can't tell that. Yeah, you can't man up on nobody, can you? They tell you, boy, you better go on before I call your wife. You gonna beat you down. Yeah, turn your man card in, boy. You good. And let me say this too, since I'm on that. You know, don't be trying to intimidate your husband. Men get nervous when women do that. You know, especially a guy who's been taught that's not something he's supposed to ever do, put his hands on a woman. You know, just because he's been taught that and it's biblically correct, he shouldn't ever do that. Amen. That don't mean you're supposed to take advantage of that. Amen. You know, you got the chicken neck and all up in his face. He came to leave. He trying to leave and here you come. Just pecking down. He trying to leave. You done pecked him out the room, down the hall. Get back in here. I'm serious. A real man, he don't know what to do because that's contrary to his nature. You know, he'd rather fight a battle than to be trying to fight a woman. He, you know, that's contrary to him. You know what he want to do? You got, and some ladies like that, they you know, try to intimidate that boy. And right? You don't want that. Amen. And you don't want him doing you like that. Amen. She got to walk on eggshells when she around you. That ain't what God want in a relationship. Amen. But why could not they receive him, right? And I told you, they actually did not recognize him because they was looking for something else, right? Matthew 22 and 29 says what?
Jesus answered
and said unto them,
ye do error, not knowing the scripture.
Not knowing the scripture, read.
Of the power of God.
And so my point is, you recognize Jesus by the scriptures. Right? You ever wonder why, especially in the Old Testament, that's Josh. he wanted his mama to tighten up with that bottle. Yeah, right. You ever wonder in the Old Testament where the Bible talks about don't make no graven images and likenesses of things in heaven and so forth on in the earth, right? is because you really can't recognize, see God's face through natural means. Right? And God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ wanted them to recognize him through the scriptures. The Bible said there are they that testify of him or who he is. The scriptures identify who Jesus is. Right? So the scripture had already been written. He coming riding on the colt. Right? He coming into Jerusalem. Right? And so the scripture had already identified who Jesus was going to be, and they were going to be able to recognize him because the scriptures identified him. That's why I say you don't judge a spirit by the spirit. You judge a spirit by the word. Because there are many spirits in the earth realm today. And they all are not of God. And so the way we identify what spirit is of God and what spirit is not of God is by what's written. Are y'all hear what I'm saying? So when we see Jesus, we see him based on what's written about him. He's not the picture that we hang on the wall. And I'm not finna get into that because that's a whole nother issue that the enemy used to create divisions with. Right? And so we got this thing. Was he a white man or was he a black man? Yeah, he was a Jew. Yeah, are y'all hear what I'm saying? And when you look at Jews, you see dark-skinned Jews, you see light-skinned Jews, you see Jews that look like Caucasians, you see Jews that look like African. You know what? He's every man. Some of every man is in Jesus. Are y'all hear what I'm saying? So the Bible warns us, don't get caught up into that stuff like that. It leads to division. And before you know it, you got a holy war going. So he said, you do error not knowing the what? Knowing the scriptures. So they couldn't recognize Jesus because they didn't have proper interpretation of scripture. Right? If they hadn't been so concerned about protecting their own position and their own power base, are y'all all right? They could have recognized who Jesus was when he came in there riding on that. Are y'all all right? Because what they should have done, especially them priests, they should have went to them scribes who were keepers and interpreters of the scripture and said, what does this event, how does it relate to scripture? What does this event say about the Messiah that we're supposed to be looking for? And those scribes should have went, found what Zechariah said, and they should have been able to tell the high priest, this is him. This is what the book said he was going to do. Glory to God. And one of the first things he did, he went straight to the temple. Woo! Judgment always begins at the house of God first. Because if the church is not right, we can't tell nobody else to get right. Amen. Amen. If you're living like a drunken sailor, ain't nobody got want to hear what you got to say. Y'all hear what I'm saying? And so he went straight to the temple. Turn over the tables of them that sold the money changers, selling, you know, deforming sickly sacrifices, taking advantage of the poor who could not afford to buy maybe a better sacrifice. And so they would sell diseased animals and pigeons and doves and y'all hear what I'm saying? And had the outer court of the temple, it was fumigating with all types of nasty smells, where all of those dirty, nasty, diseased animals was up in there. And they taking advantage of the poor, knowing that they could not get redemption unless they applied the sacrifice that was required. And so they said, well, you ain't got enough whole lot of money, so you just take this right here. making a games out of the people. And Jesus went in there hot and heavy. You know, that's why they didn't like him. He hit him where it hurt. In that pocketbook, yeah, he hit him where it hurt. Y'all hear what I'm saying? And the Bible says he took a cord, tied it together. Didn't say, y'all leave my house, please. Bible says he took that car, and he went in there, and he whipped them jokers out of there. Yeah, like Harrison Ford with that whip. This is kind of love Harrison Ford, y'all. Y'all pray for her. Harrison Ford. I don't know. He ain't got nothing on me. I don't know what the deal is. What you say? What did you say? He old. He just crashed his plane the other day. They gave his license back, though. Yeah, y'all are, but the Bible said they erred because they didn't know the scripture. They couldn't identify him from the word. If they had been in the book, they would have been able to know who he was when he came in. And they could have been rejoicing too. Is that all right? Now listen, Monday was the second day of Passion Week. I'm not going to be before you much longer. The previous Saturday being the last day of the week and Sunday being the first day of the week. Y'all got it? So Sunday is the first day of the week. On Monday, Jesus returned with the disciples to Jerusalem. Along the way, Jesus had cursed a fig tree because it had failed to bear fruit for him at a time when he was hungry. Right? Go to Matthew 21 and 17. Y'all get anything out of this? Amen. So, and of course, Mel Gibson made the movie The Passion of the Christ, right? And I literally believe, I mean, Sister Scott talked about that from time to time, that the hand of God was on him when he done that, even though he had his issues afterwards. Y'all got it? Amen. The hand of God was on him when he did that. Man, there were people in theaters, amen, crying and getting saved, you know, just watching that movie. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Amen. And so, well, he did this. He said, listen, God have always used imperfect people to fulfill his perfect plan. Amen. And that's going to be the case with you and me. Y'all, God don't find no perfect folks to do what he need done. He find imperfect people who are willing to follow him. You got it? And so, and of course, and then you know the devil didn't like that because it elevated Jesus. It elevated Jesus all over the world. You got it? And so naturally, they wanted to destroy him afterwards. You know, yeah, the devil wanted to make him trip up and lose accreditation or... Y'all got it? Amen. But man, he done the work of God there. He. Can y'all receive that? You know, one of the closest things to scripture text that's out there. Y'all got it? And I'm saying you got to stay with, well, God, Prince, I'm about to get in trouble. You got to stay with the Bible. Because there's some stuff out there. Now God is a woman. That ain't sexist. Y'all follow me? Y'all, it's just not true. Yeah, are y'all hear what I'm saying? Amen. Every description of God in the Bible has him in a masculine tent. He or him. A father. Right? If he's the father, you can't be the mother and the father. You either the father or the mother. You're not both of them. All right. Right? And God didn't take a woman out of Adam. He took a rib out of Adam, and then he made a woman. All right. So we don't need to be trying to get in touch with our feminine side. Right. Y'all hear them say, God took a rib out of Adam, and he created a woman, made a woman.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Where am I?
Matthew.
So, 21. This is on Monday, right? Jesus cursed a fig tree. Matthew 21 and 17 says what?
And he left them.
He left them and went out of the city, right?
Into Bethany,
read.
And
he lodged there. And so what it's saying is Sunday evening, he left, went to Bethany, out of the city. Can y'all see that?
Right.
Read, what it say?
Now in the morning,
that's the next day. That's Monday morning, y'all.
All right?
Next day, read, what it say?
As he returned into the city,
read.
He hungered.
Read.
And when he saw a fig tree,
he what?
He came to it.
Found nothing there on, read.
But leaves only,
read.
Said unto it,
let no fruit grow on thee.
Henceforth
now,
forever.
It's not a now and then. Okay, read.
And the fig tree withered away.
Right, read.
And when the disciples saw it,
when they saw it,
they marveled, saying,
how soon is the fig tree withered?
Read.
He answered and said unto them,
verily
I say unto you,
if ye have faith
and doubt not,
ye shall not only do this.
Can you kind of notice too how Jesus is still going on about his business? Even though he understood what was ahead of him, just a week later, he knew he was going to the cross. He knew everything that was going to happen to him. But he did not stop. That did not stop him from carrying out the Father's will each day prior to that.
All right.
Are y'all hearing? Can you see that? Amen. My point is you got to keep on doing what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
Each and every day of your life. Is that all right?
All right.
Read what it said. Say, you should not only do this,
which is done to the fig tree.
Don't wait on them, sisters. Come on.
If
you say unto this mountain,
be thou
removed,
and be cast
into the sea,
it shall be
done.
In all things,
whatsoever
you shall ask in prayer,
believe,
you shall receive.
Now this is a part, this is important, right? Because there's a great lesson being taught here by the Lord. You know, after he came into Jerusalem, right? This is on Monday, right? Listen, there are two lines of thoughts about this event. Some scholars believe that the cursing of the fig tree represented God's judgment on the spiritually dead religious leaders of Israel.
Woo!
Is that all right? Others believe that the symbolism was extended to all believers, demonstrating that genuine living faith is more than just an outward religiosity, but true faith that bears fruits and results, right, in the life of the believer. And so we want to have the type of faith, the Lord is saying, that bears fruit, that brings about manifestation, that causes you to see the answer to prayer. Can y'all see that? Right. And so, you know, the Lord wants all of our lives to bear fruit.
Amen.
You got it? He wants all of our lives to bear fruit. Now, you have to be careful because what happens, you know, some people interpret the way he does that wrong. Okay. Now, normally when you have a tree that's not bearing, according to Scripture, you prune it. Right? You cut, you know, stuff away, right? Especially if you got limbs on it that then died out or whatever have you, right? And if you prune it, and then the next time, or maybe even that same season, it might begin to produce fruit, right? Is that right? Amen. And so there's a teaching out there that talks about when God gets ready to prune people, what he does is he takes them through hardship and trial and testing to cause them to give up those things that'll keep them from bearing fruit. Y'all ever heard that kind of? Well, no. The way God prunes is he brings you to his house when you are signed. You're in the rotation on Sundays and Tuesdays, right?
Amen.
Then he causes his shepherd, right, to take the sword of the Spirit, which is his word, right? And prune away from you all of those things that will keep you from bearing fruit. That's how God does that. He don't have to send you through H-E double hockey stick and high water in order to get that done, right? If you come to the house of God, are y'all all right? You will get pruned. And you won't be bleeding when you leave here. You have all your fingers and toes. Can y'all see that? The Bible said we are clean through the word. Can y'all see that? You ever been pruned since you've been here?
Amen.
Yeah, I mean, you know. And I ain't saying it always feels good. But sometimes it be stuff on us we don't know dead. It's stuff we don't realize need to be cut off. Right? And if you got a skillful surgeon, he'll have you laughing while he cutting. That's what it is. You're in the anesthesia. You laughing, don't even feel it. Yeah, right. But they ain't even see me cut that. And I'll be saying, man, if I got away with that, I might ought to cut something else. Right. I said it like one of them kung fu movies. That guy pull out that sword, cut you for your stuff. You didn't even see the sword come out. You were grinning. Yeah, all right, come on. Stuff then cut all off of them, right? So God prunes you, man, through the teaching of the word. Amen. Lord, have mercy. I told you on Monday, he went into the temple. He turned over the table to the money changers of them that sold doves. Amen. Drove them out. He did that for two reasons, and I'm through for today. One, the ones that sold doves and another sacrifice had become corrupt, taking advantage of the people, even selling inferior sacrifice. Number two, this act was a cleansing of the temple, was symbolic of the fact that a new dispensation also was at hand. The end of the law had come and the beginning of grace was about to be instituted. Y'all got it? In St. John 1:17, the Bible says the law was given by Moses, but grace.